Welcome back. I'm Alfred Lambert Weber, and today we have, I think, an extraordinary roundtable with two extraordinary guests. Both of them are high government servants, I would say. We're with from the UK with Town Councilor Simon Parks, who can best describe his background, and also with U.S. Marine Captain Randy Cramer's special section, I must add.
It's always important to add the special section. Otherwise,
yes.
Otherwise, we're not making the right distinction there. Thank you.
Exactly. So welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you for having me again, Alfred. It's great to be back.
Yes. Thank you for joining us on what we conceived as a special roundtable. And what the roundtable part of it is really to encourage this as an opportunity for a conversation amongst yourselves, because you are extraordinary earth human beings in that you have personally experienced either face to face and or interdimensionally or both up close and personal experience with reptilian extraterrestrials, mantid beings, and in a very inside of a strategic military or intelligence context and or otherwise. And I would say that you're both very considered officers of state, either formal or informal. And by that I mean that Simon, and please correct me if I'm wrong, you are an elected public official, a town councilor in North America, as you stated. We would call that a city councilor. However, you've also been given tours of the secret military bases in the UK, meaning that the UK is confident enough of you so as to give you some insight of what they're doing. And Randy, you are active in public under authorization of Article 21 of a special Marine Corps regulations, which under circumstances were either 50% of...
I'll just quickly interject here. That's specifically under the United States Marine Corps Special Section Special Code of Conduct.
Exactly. Which makes it official. And
right.
You have been authorized by your chain of command to go public because there has been a finding, official finding, that one of these two conditions obtain or both, that either 50% of the constitutional guarantees in the U.S. Constitution are not, in fact, in place because of actions of an extraterrestrial origin or of an extraterrestrial civilization, or second, that, and please correct me if I'm wrong, 75% of the normal functioning government operations of the United States are somehow compromised. Is that the sense of it, or?
You're pretty close there. It's either a 50% or greater reduction or compromise in personnel of the known apparatus of state or government, or a 75% reduction in overall effectiveness or use. So if you're, essentially we see the gears grinding to a halt, you know, at greater than a 75% rate, it's considered to be hostile. And an aggressive act that's trying to, you know, bring us to a slowdown or a shutdown, which is not a good thing at all, and therefore can be seen as a hostile act and crosses a condition line where you can say, before that, someone else should have done their job, but if they didn't by the time we get to that 75% mark, then these other clauses go into effect so that officers can take action in their best moral conscience and so forth like that.
Okay, now... Does that 75% have the condition that that condition has to obtain to an extraterrestrial cause, or can it be to a terrestrial cause?
It's presumed at this point that that regardless of whether it's a terrestrial or extraterrestrial cause, you know, sort of at its origins, yeah. that because of all the players that are involved, that it's presumed to be a hostile action from someone outside of us or threatening us. Whether it's internal or external becomes irrelevant. It's clearly someone who's threatening the apparatus and the functionality of state at that point, which is sedition and treason, and threatens the entire apparatus and the safety of everyone.
Okay, just to be clear. So I just wanted to establish, Simon and Randy, that you're really here both as state actors. Simon, would you agree with that?
It's quite a loaded question there, Alfred.
I know. That's my job.
I think I share something with Rand in that in many ways the establishment doesn't quite know where to sit us. Some arms of the establishment would clearly like to use us for its own purposes, while other arms of the establishment just want the truth to come out. Both Randy and I have been given either formal or informal protection. In my case, I've been given very obvious support. And so, in a way, yes, is the answer, Alfred. The establishment is backing us to a certain degree. And perhaps only part of the establishment is backing us.
Yes, yes. Now, having gotten that out of the way, just so that our viewers understand the full context of our roundtable, shall we go to the first part of it? And that is... to really introduce the viewers in a conversation, because both of you have had experiences with mantids, for example, and I wondered if starting with Simon, you could say in 3 or 4 minutes. Just describe yours, and then Randy, if you could come in and begin to talk to each other as a round table and see what the comparative, what points of comparison and differences you can come up with, almost as though we're at a seminar.
Okay, all right. It'll be interesting for Randy because he's been in combat with certain different races. And I don't know if the listeners who are going to listen to this will remember the one I did with you, Alfred, but I talked about 1971 when I made a soul agreement with a mantid, or as the North Americans say, a mantis. And part of that agreement was that my soul could be taken from my body and placed into a mantis body, and then I would then go out and do certain things. It'll be quite interesting for Randy because when we interact, I will have two viewpoints. One viewpoint as somebody who lives on this planet now, but as somebody who has inhabited a mantid soul. And, you know, taken a somewhat different view. So my experience with a mantis really goes down to the time when I was asked to choose who did I want to associate with. Would it be the Draconis reptilian or would it be the mantis? And I chose to be more involved with the mantis and not the Draconis. And although the Draconis retreated from my life, it never completely left it. So from a very small child, I have experiences of mantis creatures. I also have experiences of shadow creatures, the feline species, crystalline creatures. Very rarely see the greys. I do not get on with the greys at all. They're corrupt humans, or some of them are. The robotic greys I have absolutely no time for because they have no soul in them. But I don't see many of them. So I'm more associated with the mantis than any other being, but I'm very familiar with the Draconis reptilian. And these visits and associations are ongoing. I've probably got a minute left now, Alfred.
Sorry.
No, it's fine. I'm just conscious that I don't want to talk for too long. When I first went public, then the media, the established media, did attack me, as you would expect. And then something very odd happened. In Britain, we have what we call the Ministry of Defence, which is the government ministry that is in charge of all the decisions taken at a military level. And I was invited for a tour of a secret space radar base, which actually isn't British, it's American. It's run by the National Security Agency. But because it's based on Britain, then obviously the British are in charge of the front door, for want of a better purpose. And I had a four-hour tour around that space base. And this completely was a game changer, because how was it that this guy, Simon, whose mother actually worked for MI5, but was really working for the NSA, whose grandfather worked for MI6, but who was really working for the CIA, and who went public that he had had these alien contacts, why was this guy being given a four-hour tour around a very top-secret base, and at the end of it was presented with a little medallion? There were 15 of us in the tour, and I was the only non-military person there. And at the end of it, I was presented with a small coin. There were only 500 of them made in the world, made by the Americans. And they were to be given to generals, admirals, presidents, prime ministers. And there I am, just a humble city councillor. And at the end of it, I'm given the presentation. And when I go around and do my lectures, of course, I carry it with me and show people. So it comes back to your question that, yes, the establishment is involved there. So I hope in a nutshell I've tried to give a picture there, Alfred.
Good. Yes, Randy, could you just kind of respond and talk about your interactions with mantids over the next 3 to 4 minutes or so?
Sure. Primarily, my first interaction was essentially a intelligence briefing and virtual training experiences. So my first interactions was more like a virtual three-dimensional video game experience, which was quite terrifying because we're just sort of assaulted by swarms and swarms and swarms of insects. Just over and over and over again, and it's kind of freaky. I still don't like swarms of bugs or stinging insects. It still kind of weirds me out. Now I'm still the guy that, you know, if I see a bee, you know, struggling on the sidewalk, I'll go, oh, come here, little bee, let me help you out. I mean, I don't hate insects in any way, shape, or form, but they still give me the creepies and the willies sometimes because of that combat trauma experience. So my first experience was just like, this is the enemy, this is the beast, this is what you have to be concerned about. And my first physical interactions with them were just, you know, combat-oriented, which were really, really messy. I don't know any other nice way or without trying to be graphic. It was just not a messy, it was just a very unclean, messy experience, both physically, emotionally, tactically, strategically. It's just a very, very messy experience trying to engage in combat with an organized insect hive mind. I'll just have to say that. They're incredibly organized, and it's really difficult to sort of tactically approach an opponent like that without having to really think outside the box, because they just defy, you know, 9 out of 10 of the reasons that you think when you do A, your opponent is going to do B, but you're presuming that basically on sort of mammalian interactions and psychological processes and not on an insect hive mind, which is completely different. So it really changes the day. I will say, however, that my first experience that was peaceful with them was kind of on my own impetus, really. We had regular patrols, which is part of our daily routine. And so
These are on Mars.
On Mars, yes, correct.
Just to set the context for the viewers.
Correct. I'm sorry. Yeah, this is beyond the surface of Mars between 1987 and, like, I'm talking sort of between 1987 and 1995 is sort of my first interactions, and before this first time that I actually encountered them personally was probably about, would have been maybe about 1990, 91, sort of. I'd only been there maybe 3 or 4 years. And so we were on a patrol, and we were, you know, coming across this sort of territorial line where we could see the mantids out sort of from their hive, engaging in some sort of activity. Looked like they were bringing things out and sort of laying lines out of things and sort of into the daylight or into the sun, it turns out, for some reason. And as we were watching and doing our patrol, and we're supposed to just get to a certain point, observe whatever's happening, and then turn, and I just found myself, like, really trying to think hard about everything that I could remember from junior high or high school biology class about insects. And I said, you know, I'm willing to bet that if I put down my gun and I walk over there, not threatening, that they're not going to attack me. And essentially, you know, the squad was like, sure, go ahead. You know, I mean, we don't think you're correct necessarily about that. But yeah, I mean, you want to go get ripped apart, you know, sure, we'll jump in and grab your head and take you back and get you rebuilt again, like always. But, you know, we don't think that's necessarily a good idea. And I said, well, you know what? I think it is. So I don't think that approaching as a singular entity that I'm going to get attacked. And if I'm wrong, then I will come back running, screaming, I was wrong. But that's not what happened. So I put down my weapons and I approached. And the closer I got, obviously, the more I could notice that they were attending that I was approaching. And then when one of the, I'd call them sort of one of the more intelligent drones, which are sort of a, you know, 5.5-ish feet tall sort of combination of what I would say between a mantid person or a mantis person and an ant person, and sort of, you know, approached and was communicating psionically pretty clearly. We had a very brief conversation about, hi, I'm from up there and we live over there, and, you know, hi, I'm from up there and we live over here. And we essentially were able to start, you know, a passive enough dialogue at that point that when I went back and filled out my report, a CO called me in and was like, did you really walk up to the front of the hive and just wave and say hi? And I said, yeah, I did. I just walked up and waved and said hi. And he just kind of shook his head and said, wow, that is brass buttons, my friend. That is really brass buttons. And it essentially, so what we did at that point was, I know that the diplomatic corps was engaging in diplomatic conversations with the insects and with the mantids at that point. Even though we were continuing to sometimes engage with them militarily, that didn't seem to stop the diplomatic process from going on. They really seemed to be very independent, you know, mechanically of one another. And I would say by the time that we settled into a temporary peace agreement, we had an exchange program where a couple of squads of soldiers and some officers from the diplomatic corps on a daily basis, you know, we'd get up in the morning, the barracks, and head over to the hive and spend the day with the mantids and their cult, and then mostly the diplomatic corps officers doing, you know, their diplomatic corps stuff, and the soldiers just sort of helping out and standing around. But we would still engage and communicate, and found it a very interesting process. And I was completely astonished at their incredible intellect, their brilliant understanding of biochemistry, genetic engineering, and the science stuff that they're really, really focused on. They're really, really good at. So at first, you know, we just sort of think that, they're giant kind of smart insects. No. I mean, they're just, like, really smart, genius evolved scientists that can really do some amazing things. My understanding pretty much of how they did almost everything was they didn't build much of anything. They engineered things. They designed things and then would make an insect or a bug or a thing that would do that process or do that function, and then could recycle back into a system that's recycling organic matter all the time, being managed sort of by a queen hive mind into sort of a collective of souls of other smaller souls in the hive mind that are all experiencing hive consciousness. Anyway, I could go on a bit, but it was fascinating. It was very fascinating, incredibly interesting. But also, I will just point out, it was a little weird. Like, I had to go to medical and get, you know, some prescriptions for anti-anxiety medication and stuff when I was doing this duty, because I would get so nervous and so anxiety ridden being surrounded by all of these insects that I was used to, you know, only being surrounded of when I was in, you know, defensive combat with. So there was a serious anxiety that I had to deal with, and they were cool with, and but to the point where I had to get an anxiety drug prescription so that I could calm down for a while in their presence, because I was just too freaked out at being around giant bugs still.
Thank you for that remarkable summary. Now, I'm just having gotten this out, Simon, having heard and seen Randy's experience and introduction to mantids to us mere earth dwellers, I was wondering, would you like to ask Randy some questions, or first make some observations? As you say, a person of dual or integrated human mantid essence, please feel free to engage.
Two statements, one question.
Yeah,
The first one is that it's a patriarchal society, not a matriarchal society.
Okay, so that's interesting. Okay.
Male that runs the hive. Secondly, Randy is absolutely right. The whatever combat or battle goes on, the diplomacy carries on without any issue whatsoever. The domino game that takes place is the game of life, and that's just the way it is. The question I have for Randy, is, Randy, were you at that time employed by the United States military in one shape or another, or were you employed by a multi-corporation private company?
This is a very good question, and my understanding, the only way I know how to explain that is to say that the Mars Defense Force is a private military contractor who is contracted by the Mars Colony Corporation. So wow. The MCC is sort of this financial organizational arm, and the MDF is not directly owned or commanded by the MCC. They are contracted, but they have to be made up of some of these other military contractors, which are still make up the EDF and Naval Space Command and these other military agencies. So it becomes managed as a private military organization, which means it's infused with a lot of corporate management. But yes, you still have a hierarchy of soldiers and officers who are contracted and coming right out of these other direct military programs in order to run that private military organization, because they've definitely learned the mistake of letting private industry individuals actually get their hands in the military part. That's a very, very bad thing to let happen. And you still always want to have the military folks running the military programs whenever you can. That still means that the corporate people get their fingers in everything as far as what tools are being approved or used, or policies are being approved or used. But I will say that the military commanders, you know, have a certain amount of ability to put their foot down and say, no, 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 this is garbage. And I can tell you a number of times when my commanding officer at Forward Station Zebra, several issues, really just said, no, 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 this is stupid. We are not doing it this way anymore. This is harming my effectiveness of my soldiers. This is harming our day-to-day morale. This is harming our ability to function. This is harming our ability to perform in the field. And so I will not be doing it that way. We will be doing it this way or else. And seeing, you know, essentially the MCC have to capitulate to military command when military command says, you know, absolutely not. We will not be doing that way. It's a back and forth. It's a back and forth of power.
Okay. Two questions. Would it be right to say that at a point Dick Cheney was probably in charge of that particular arm? And would it also be say that at the time that you were on Mars, the humans had the technology to bring you back to life had you been physically dead?
I would say to that first part that Dickie Cheney is almost assuredly involved at somewhere in these areas, and it was exactly what level he would have been involved in the MDF. or the Earth Defense Force. I couldn't say specifically, but I would almost be certain that his thumbprints and his fingerprints would be all over it somewhere. And then, yes, I would also say that we definitely had the technology at that point. You know, I've had my arms and legs and my body blown apart so many times and rebuilt and put back together. So, and as long as there's some electrical activity that they can connect, you know, your cord to, they can still bring you back. They're still retrievable, yes, and they'll still bring your soul back into your body. It's, yes, when that connection is completely gone that you become all the way dead, or as we, yes, used to say.
That's brilliant. Thanks ever so much. Thank you.
Wow. Please continue. I mean, this is a remarkable disclosure roundtable.
Well, what we're seeing here is things that people don't read on the internet, what you haven't read in a book. You would only know this if you were actually really there, or whether you had very close connection with it. So the sort of questions I'm asking Randy, he couldn't answer if he just read it on the internet or a book. He would have had to have experienced it. So, and I would only ask the questions because I am aware of it. So what makes it so lovely is that you know, there are three very genuine people on this round table at the moment.
Excellent. That, let's go over and Randy, do you have, would you like to ask, make a statement about what Steinman has said, and then ask him questions?
Okay, I guess I'm curious. I mean, why wouldn't you be curious necessarily about Dick Cheney's involvement? Because he's, I mean, or someone, I like to call him Darth Cheney, really, because he's such, you know, this figure who's just always trying to be behind and controlling so much of everything. And there's just not a single indication that he's up to anything other than, you know, bad feelings all around, and that, you know, the dark side of the force moves through him with great strength. I just don't know how else to describe him. So I just find it curious why you would ask that question specifically. I think that my question would sort of center around, we had a limited experience with the hive, meaning sort of we really only experienced one hive, but there were multiple hives that were run by, you know, multiple collective consciousness. And my question being, because this has always been a note of curiosity to me, the hive consciousness that exists from, you know, the sort of top down from a hive, how connected or as much of the same hive consciousness is that from hive to hive or queen to queen, or does that change? Does it really have sort of a more of a division, like people or individual persons have a division, even though they're collectives? This is a very interesting subject to me, and since I don't really have an experience with multiple hives to be able to judge that, I would have to ask the question. If you could answer that, I'd be dying to know.
Okay, there are no queens. It's
okay,
a patriarchal society. The pyramid shape is good. That works. There is one, and his title in English would be simply the Great One.
Okay.
The Great One. That is what you're referring to as the Queen.
Okay.
Although he's male.
Okay, sure. I can totally understand my confusing of that, because it's certainly the grand progenitor, the grand engineer, and the grand maker of everything. And I think that just communication was always purveying that was the Queen. So thanks for clarifying that. I'll try to make sure I clarify that in the future.
In different locations on different planets, different universes, there will be what you're describing, a standalone unit, which would be one hive.
Okay.
That hive, if I can put that here and a hive here, this is the communication that you're asking from. So you would have, from the center, it wouldn't come from one hive who would then pass it to another hive, which is perhaps how we would do it in Earth-human terms. One command center would be responsible for feeding off to others. This comes from one to all simultaneously, so that if one arm is cut out, all the separate hives have the same information at the same time. Now, there is communication from one hive to another, But that isn't reporting. That's just status. So it's not reporting. It's just a continual update of what's happening. It's not a chain of command which goes that way. So that's how that works. So you could take out one hive. That's my cat behind me going.
Yes, I see that. You're very acrobatic.
Yes, I thought it was a djinn for a moment, Alfred, but it's just a cat. So yeah, you could take out one hive, but all the others would be standalone. So I don't know if that helps in any way.
Oh, that completely answers my question. Yes, thank you very, very much. That helps a lot.
Okay. Right. Would you like to have some? Would anyone like to come forth with a follow-on question?
Yeah, I don't have any knowledge of being on Mars. I don't have any knowledge of that yet. I seem to have a very clear understanding of bits and pieces. Randy, would it be correct to say that certain parts of Mars were quadranted or divided off between different groupings? So a geographical area would belong to one particular race, and a geographical area would belong to another race, because I'm aware that diplomatically, in order to allow one group into another group's territory, there was a very complicated protocol. Does that make sense?
Yes, and my understanding is that, yeah, Mars is in no way a cohesive, you know, unified, one, you know, planetary government species, you know, kind of a situation at all, that there are definitely multiple species and folks involved, you know, natives and non-natives, people, natives maybe who went away and are coming back, and different ways that you can look at that. But yeah, my understanding, there's at least a half a dozen or so different genetically distinct species that possess and compete for a certain amount of territory. But I want to emphasize again, when people want to talk about that competing for territory, that they often assume that there's this fight for global dominance on Mars by these species, and nothing could be farther from the truth, because a long time ago it was simply determined that that was not going to be militarily or financially practical at all, and that you were simply going to have to settle for maintaining your territory and, you know, trying to keep anybody else from taking too much or pushing in too many of a direction over your own territory. But the notion of any one of those species dominating all of the rest and being able to own that planet is simply a joke. It's just a joke. The idea that it could happen is ridiculous. And yeah, I mean, my understanding is some are more friendly and on better terms than others, and some are obviously more hostile. I can only speak really clearly about what happened near the sort of northern polar regions where I was at, involving our stations, these northern tribe reptiles tribes, and the mantid tribe species that we dealt with.
The raptor ones, aren't they the ones that are associated with the United States Navy? Is that right? Is it the Air Force or the Navy that have connections with them?
The Navy definitely does. I don't think I'd be authorized to comment on that, because I don't know enough about it. And if I would be saying something that would harm anything in a secure way, I wouldn't know that necessarily either. So I'd be best not to say anything specifically, other than that, yeah, the Navy is certainly, Naval Space Command and United States Marine Corps Special Section, I know, still has diplomats constantly communicating with the Northern Tribe Raptors, yeah.
That was my understanding. That's brilliant. Yeah. Randy, there's a couple of films which I'm sure you've seen, and I think will mean a lot to you. And one, obviously, is Total Recall with Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
And the other one is Ender's Game. Have you seen Ender's Game?
I did. I saw it not too long ago, and it was really mind-blowing as far
as...
Yeah, I mean, I had people who friends who'd seen it who were telling me, no, you really want to see this movie. It's about the training program. And I was like, okay, we'll see how good it is. And I was quite shocked and quite stunned to see just how clear they were being without being more clear.
And you see the mantis-type creature at the end of the film.
Yes, I thought that was absolutely fascinating.
Yeah,
yeah, it was really.
In actual fact, the Ender's Game is stock filming for the Marine Corps. It's actually on their list of approved films to watch when they're in their training.
I'm not surprised at all. I'm not surprised. In fact, I really, so many times hearing lines, you know, being quoted from these officers that I would just swear I have heard these same bullet points, you know, rattled off to me by my same chain of command, that I have a hard time not believing that somebody helped write the script for that. So it really seemed not just like someone said, hey, I got a good idea for you. I think someone came to somebody with a ready script and said, why don't you make that movie?
Yes.
Yeah, but it was great. It was fantastic. And I think anyone who wants to try and understand the sort of mentality of these programs and who is being used and why they're being made and what direction they're trying to be directed in order to develop skills and so forth. No, I think it's a great example.
I think it's very important because it actually shows children being trained, which is what you were saying. And anybody who's understands military discipline knows that and Adolf Hitler understood it entirely when he trained the Hitler Youth, that if you get children at a young age, you can create a very, very effective fighting force. And that is exactly what the military or the large corporations who own or part own some of these military programs have been doing for a while. So it's really nice for me to actually meet Randy and to chat with him, because we're seeing things from, yes, the same perspective, but also a slightly different perspective. But we are not antagonists. That's very important to make clear, because had I been a greatly more reptilian type being, I would probably be having a real problem with Randy right now, Alfred. But that is not the case.
Why do you say that? What would if you were a reptilian being, what is there about Randy and what he's doing or saying that would bring up problems?
Randy has more than average reptilian in him anyway, and he knows that is the case. And Randy's, again, is absolutely correct that the parts of Mars, as other planets are, which are segmented off, your own operational field is defined. The reptilian grouping finds it very hard to play within the rules, and will attempt both physically and non-physically to expand its influence. And so somebody like Randy is probably what he represents is basically, if you go too far, you are going to have conflict on an ongoing basis. And so you are constantly reminded with somebody like Randy on a planet's surface that the humans have, yes, they're there by agreement, but they also have their own agenda. And the Mantids are incredibly spiritual in some ways and incredibly ancient and learned and have got so much going on that they're not that worried. But the reptiles are very much into expansion of territory, dominating species, controlling people, and so therefore what Randy represents is probably a little bit difficult for some of the reptiles. Randy can tell you more than I can about that.
Mm-hmm. Could we, just going back, Randy, you mentioned that there were six major species on Mars?
At least, that I'm aware of.
Okay,
yeah.
I assume that three of those are reptile, mantid, human. Is that correct?
We have terrestrial humans, you know, from Earth. We also have Martian humans, who are from Mars, you know, sort of hominids that are from Mars.
Right.
And then there's, I know Andrew's described them as sort of a small, you know, type, almost gray or zeta type being. I'm not sure what to call them, because he came up with some names, some Latin variation names, which is fine, right. But I'm not sure what how they're defined in the manual, because to me they fit a description of drone being, and so in the list of various drone beings, it's not always about what species they are because they're drone beams. They're like biological robots, and so they can sort of essentially be operated or teleoperated or programmed by a number of other species as proxy who don't want to either engage in the environment, the biological environment. They know they're vulnerable to mold, spores, fungi, and so forth in the environment. They don't want to wear the bio suits. The gravity or the pressure is too different for them to survive in, so they'll use a biological drone to teleoperate in that area. And so my understanding is that they may not even be their own like biological species. They're just sort of like biological robots. So who they're actually being operated by or teleoperated by, I can't say, and therefore I wouldn't define them as an actual species. I would more define them as a biological drone or a biological robot. And so I'd say there's at least those species. We had, you know, a draconian infiltration that we pretty much extracted as a group effort. You know, we all got together and sort of, you know, ganged up on the draconians when they thought they were going to come in and play divide and conquer. But I would just only imagine from what I know that there's got to be a couple of other hangers-on somewhere, you know, sort of in that map, even though I'm not privy to the entire map of the entire globe of Mars. But I'd say, from my intelligence sources, we got to be, you know, half a dozen or seven or eight species, which, you know, have territory that puts them in a position of having to be negotiated with. If you're talking about global affairs, if you're talking about Martian global affairs or things that will affect everybody, I mean, even if they're all fighting each other, there's has to be some sort of loose diplomatic organization around what's acceptable and not acceptable for everyone, because that always is going to come down to it. Even if you've got people fighting, you still got people with interests who can go, no, it's really going to cost us too much if we do that. We need to, you know, work together on this, even though we're fighting them over here. If we cooperate on this, that saves everybody time, money, and energy. That's always, I think historically, that's always been the case, where just because you're militarily, you know, stomping on someone doesn't mean you're over here having a conversation with them about how to minimize certain negative impacts because of the war that they're having or because of some other environmental factor. So I think the fact that we've got a messy situation geopolitically shouldn't surprise us. I think that we have a messy situation geopolitically on Earth. I think we should expect messy geopolitical situations on Mars and just about every other planet in the galaxy, because why wouldn't there be? Why would we presume that everyone's got some kind of orderly global functionary system where their planet is just all fine and orderly and peaceful and where everyone gets along and agrees that the laws should all be the same? I don't see why that should be the case at all. Even when you're talking about collective consciousness and hive consciousness, my experience individually was that an individual mantid could still have an opinion that was separate from the hive. It would still, you know, go with what sort of with the hive logic and the hive notion and survival of the hive, but you know, they could still sort of have an individual opinion. I don't know how else to describe that, except that, you know, one mantid soul conscious might prefer that flavor to that flavor or that color to that color in the same way that you or I might. They might be able to have that kind of an opinion because it doesn't impact the overall health or well-being of the hive, so it's not dictated by hive consciousness. Again, Simon probably knows more about this than I do. This is my impression of them. But that in and of itself, to me, just seemed like part of the individual expression that when you have these individual life forms getting together in groups, they have many differences of opinion and they disagree a lot and they don't agree on how to do things and what the best way to do things are. So I think we should anticipate that intergalactic geopolitical affairs are going to be much, much, much more complicated and messy than our own geopolitical affairs because they involve more parties.
Right. Holding that issue for a moment. Simon, do you have any comments on what Randy just said about mantids?
Yes, because there is still free will. Providing that free will doesn't endanger the race. There is a high council within the mantis, and it runs on a traffic light system, red, yellow, and green. Somewhat like the weapons that some of the humans have. I don't know, laser rifles, but we're talking energy hand weapons that some of the human troops carry. But anyway, the High Council, like any council, has a vote except being telepathic. The telepathy is counted by votes, but not by raising your hand. But yes, there is free will to make decisions, but those decisions must always be for the benefit of the race. So it is quite possible that, I'll give you an example. Let us suggest that a mantid is on Earth in its true form, interacting with a human child at maybe, in, let's say in North America, at maybe 2:30 in the morning. And then that mantid then wishes to bring that child either to a spacecraft or to an underground base or to another dimension. And it will either take that child physically in its body or it will take its energetic signature. Now, when it gets to wherever it's getting, let us suppose that another mantid then interacts with that child and a new connection is made between that child and that mantid, which is, seems beneficial. The first mantid will say, shall I withdraw, and therefore allow you to carry on. So there is free will, providing it doesn't violate the number one rule, which is the survival of the collective. Okay.
This is, I know that this might seem strange, but we are prompted by that conversation of reptilians, mantids, to humans, and the different territorials. Could we transfer that same conversation to Earth and start up a conversation about here on Earth? Is there a similar struggle for territory between humans, reptilians, mantids, etc.?
No. I mean, Randy will come in with his bit. The only struggle we've had has been some of the taking out of the dumps, some of the deep underground bases. That's the major struggle we've seen on the planet. But the division of Earth was decided a very long time ago. In other words, the running, who was in charge and how. The difficulty we've had from a good perspective is that those elite governments now so totally control a number of countries with their corporations and their politicians that it isn't actually the aliens that are the problem anymore. It's the humans in their very, very strong positions who are just totally greedy and totally out for themselves. So the from my perspective, you don't have turf war, as we say in Britain. You have countries who are seeking to push their ideology onto others. So there's that going on. But it's more to do with humans and demonic entities than it is to do with aliens, who are actually now not playing the key role they might have done 20 years ago.
Do you have any comment on that?
Certainly. Terrestrial Earth geopolitics is very complicated, but I will try and say that Simon is correct. My understanding, there are no territorial conflicts in which we are concerned about mantid or insect species territorially competing for territory on Earth. The ones that I understand that are here completely on based on treaties that are that everyone's okay with and are not here to do harmful or negative things. Of all of the ET species that we have over the last 70 years, say, made treaties with and let them come and hang out, that's not necessarily the case. Of some of those, we've had to learn that those are bad relationships, and we've had to, you know, break them up and break off with them, and in some cases, you know, kick them out of the neighborhood and tell them, you know, out, don't come back. It's very complicated, and because you have factions within factions who are have different agendas going, you know, both opposite directions on the fork in the road of sort of, do we move towards golden civilization or total fascist civilization? Because that's the tug of war. People don't understand the tug of war. It's we're either tug of war for golden civilization, fascism, or it's all going to break and collapse into barbarism. That's essentially the sort of tug of war that's happening because of all these different interests. And we really have the choice of trying to understand those forces and direct it back towards golden civilization, where, you know, we shore up the things of civilization that are crumbling and falling apart, and we eliminate poverty, and we eliminate the reason for people to have to be using large amounts of bombs and chemical weapons on each other, and we make, you know, law enforcement officers accountable for killing people for committing misdemeanors or just standing, you know, leaning against a toy. You know, there are things that have to be made accountable and fixable in order to move in that direction. But a lot of what I think is being directed by that are, I would have to agree with Simon, it's less the ETs that were giving us the same trouble maybe 20 years ago, and we now have these proxies of human beings who are operating through sort of multidimensional beings, you know, sort of puppeteering in this corporate model, which is a draconian model. I want to point out that the corporate model, the corporate banking model, is a draconian model. The alpha draconian model is all about corporate banking. It's all about usury and making imaginary money to hold people in debt to, and creating, you know, hierarchical corporations to subvert law and order and so forth. That's their structure. So the fact that, you know, they infiltrated that sort of inter-earth structure by creating the East India Trading Company, the first corporation, you know, has got us in down to a direction that we don't understand how to reel in business power. And I don't think that there shouldn't be business power. There should be some business power, but that's not the same thing as corporate power, and that's not the same thing as saying, you know, 90-day, you know, three-month planning is our bottom line, what I like to call the short-term greedy model, which I'm highly against. Business models have to be, how do we make productivity, you know, in capital over 100 years, not 3 months. So what we're mostly seeing right now are some really, really, really dark psionic beings, or what some people might refer to demonic beings, dark energy, dark wizards, dark magic, whatever you want to call them. They're using very, very negative dark psionic energy to manipulate and bend reality and behavior in a certain way. I would argue that we don't have a pedophile problem because we have a pedophile problem. I would argue we have a pedophile problem because dark psionic magic users have been sending those frequencies into society over and over and over again until people start mimicking and puppeteering that behavior. And that if we eliminated those sources of psionic infiltration into that thinking, that behavior would come to an end. It would stop.
Very interesting. Do you have comments to that, perspective, Simon, and your furry friend.
This is my cat who is incredibly jealous when I take it all to him.
Get some attention.
Yeah. No, just absolutely agree entirely with Randy. It's getting very boring, this, isn't it, Alfred?
We just agreeing with each other all the time?
Yeah.
Well, no, these are collective perspectives that a round table comes to. That's why it's round.
Okay. All right. King Arthur. Yes. The whole of this prison planet is draconis reptilian created in terms of its systems and its structures, which then those humans who are so desperate to climb the ladder to be something are embraced and are part of it. And sometimes it's willing, and sometimes it's not willing. In most cases, they are mind-controlled, bloodline families. It's a very, very interesting, if horrific, control network and control system. But, you know, from a dispassionate point of view, I have to say it's very effective. And Randy will know that many people have suicide programs placed in them so that if they begin to break the programming or they turn against their masters, they will be dead within a fortnight. And as far as the authorities are concerned, they just committed suicide. So looking at one aspect, it appears to be sewn up. However, Randy's right. There is something very important going on. And slowly but surely, the off-worlders or the bad guys on the planet are losing control, not just of the populace, but they're losing control in many cases within their own organization. There are a large number of people who are saying, you know what, I don't want this anymore. I can't live with myself. I can't live with this. And I want out. Now, as you go higher up the chain of command, this is not necessarily in the corporations, but I do believe it's in the pure military, where these people believe themselves to be custodians of the peace of the planet. That's how they see themselves, as custodians of the peace of the planet. Because when you are aware that it isn't a war with Russia that's going to cause you serious problems, it is the potential war with races from other worlds. When you know that, everything else becomes much less important. And so you begin to realize that they've had enough, that humanity has been lied to. This is such a big story, and surely human race can move on and develop. It's time to grow up. And so you have a number of people in very high office, military office, and a few politicians who have come together quite secretively, forming their own groups within groups within groups, trying to move it across. And you might get a major or a colonel in a military unit who will somewhat change the orders that he's been given. And that's what's occurring. And that's where I think we need to place our faith.
I think that's a very good assessment. And my experience in just talking, mostly conversations sort of off the record with various officers in a number of branches of the military, I find this consensus to be very true, that over the last couple of decades, you have, you know, people I really want to call the warrior caste of the United States of America. And when I call them that, I mean it with the deepest respect, because these are men and women who are officers now, whose parents were officers, whose grandparents were officers, whose great-grandparents were officers, whose great-grandparents served in the Civil War, and whose great-great-great-parents were in the Spanish-American War. I mean, you know, there are people whose families go back for generations and have done nothing but serve this country militarily, and, you know, have nine generations of West Point graduates who take the usurpation of, you know, the Constitution and of this divide and conquer attitude, where let's pretend like we're mad at the Russians, let's pretend like we're mad at the Chinese, let's make up a war in the Middle East, really see this as a serious violation of our own sort of national security apparatus, that it makes us very vulnerable. It makes us very vulnerable internally, externally. We create terrorism every time, you know, we take our boot and stomp somebody in the head and say, do it our way. I mean, every time you do that, you know, a child is being born, or a four-year-old lost his mother or his uncle, who is going to hate you forever. And they're going to die hating you because, you know, you did something that left an impression when they were 4 years old. So when they're 18, they're going to be happy to do everything they can to kill you or harm themselves or die in the process, because when they were four, they know that the jackbooted thug of some foreign national stomped their mom or their dad or their uncle in the head. So that kind of aggression does not gain peace, does not gain submission. All it does is make people mad. And all it does is make people want to come and fight you and hurt you later. The notion of hearts and minds, that is a Marine Corps concept, and it really comes from old-fashioned wisdom. You get more flies with honey than you do with vinegar. Okay? That's, you know, not rocket science. And the Marine Corps understood a long time ago, when you go into an area, you're dealing with two different groups of people fighting almost always over a bunch of, you know, poor farmers and people who've got a couple of cows and goats to deal with. And your choice is to either look as bad as the people who you're trying to fight, or look better. And the way you look better is when you come into a community and you say, hey, you guys don't have enough food or blankets. Guess what? We got a truckload of food and blankets and rations. Here, have some stuff that will make your life a little less suffering, and we can show you we're the good guys. And the more you can demonstrate through your actions that you actually care about the people on the ground, they're going to recognize that, wow, here's a person who's actually morally upstanding, better than this guy who's telling me that I need to, you know, rise up, you know, because of these guys in the dirt of the jungle. Here, this guy's come along and he's given us blanket and food and medicine. Wow, maybe I should really, like, help this guy who just helped me and my family out and made sure that my little sister, who was going to look like she was going to die, is now alive because some doctor gave her a shot. The original idea of being able to help people in order for them to go, oh, you're the good guys, that's a Marine Corps concept. So the moment that we stopped being the good guy like that, the moment that we said, you know, we're not going to give you blankets anymore. We're not going to give you health care anymore. We're not going to give you rations anymore. We're just going to give you door-to-door, kick down, boot to the head. I don't speak your language, but I'm going to point a rifle around the room until I get everybody to do what I want. That's bad policy. That's just bad policy. And so any notion, and these officers and these military personnel, I'm getting on a rant here, these are people who are tired of seeing the good name of the military used badly. These are people who understand that the military is something that can be used to help a situation that has become chaotic, that is broken down, that is causing suffering, where you can come in, use a little force and a wedge to create some space and some peace for people and possibly eliminate harmful individuals in an area. That's the use of good military action. And when we pervert that and when we distort that, it makes people really, really angry. When the enhanced interrogations in the Army Field Manual was signed into law, the Marine Corps was given the opportunity to change its interrogation section of its manual as well to use enhanced interrogation techniques. I want to point out, the Marine Corps declined those enhanced interrogation techniques. The Marine Corps said, no, we don't need those enhanced interrogation techniques in our manual. Our interrogation technique works better. And it's a technique based on what I just described. You sit down with someone and you said you learn what their name is, who their family is, what village they come from, what town they come from, what their needs are, what their suffering is, and you say, you know what? I can help you. I can help you and your family and your situation. I can help your people be safe, but you got to give me some information. That's how the Marine Corps interrogation manual essentially works. You figure out how to make a rapport with someone, what they need and what they understand, help them achieve something, and then they're gladly going to help you and provide accurate information. So there are absolutely very, very dedicated men and women, officers, the cadre and warrior caste of the United States of America that has had enough. And I wouldn't be here if my entire chain of command had not had enough and said, okay, under these guidelines, we've had enough. You get to do this. You get to talk about this because we've had enough. And so in some ways, I get to kind of be the spokesperson for a whole bunch of other military officers that are not allowed to speak or given permission to speak. And I try and be honorable and speak for them, and you're right. They've had enough, and there's a lot of change that's going on because those men and women have had enough, and they're saying no to the people who have said, let's drive it into the ground and then rebuild it into some sort of better image, which is a bad idea. So I'm convinced more and more as the days go by that that change has been going on, will continue to go on, and you're just going to see more and more action where the black hats are losing and the good guys are winning, because those very serious people in the officer cadre who've sworn their lives and their families and their fathers and their grandfathers and their great-grandfathers' lives, they're not going to let them die in vain. It's not going to happen. I know people who simply refuse to let every soldier that died in World War I and World War II and Vietnam die in vain by just letting this roll over our entire system with a fascist military-industrial complex. That would not be the purpose of why we fought half the wars of the 20th century. There, rant over.
Thank you. Both ways.
Now, I could keep going, but I'm going to stop myself.
Okay. Shifting to a question of a change in consciousness, which I know that both of you have talked about, and I think Simon has, we've discussed the date 2017 as being a rough working date. We're now toward the end of 2014, when we have some input coming both from extraterrestrial sources and also from other places, that perhaps there'll be a shift of consciousness here on the planet. Does this relate to our conversation that we've been having both about Mars and about Earth and about different species at all?
Well, this shift has been going on for quite some time, Alfred. It's been building. It started very, very quietly and very hidden and has been rolled out across the planet. 2017 is the point that is the be-all and end-all. It's the make or break. We have 2 years or 18 months of a very rough ride between now and then, which, depending on how it goes will dictate just how rough that ride will be. Randy, I'm sure, will be able to comment that a number of occasions that would have ended this earth have been prevented, whether that be a nuclear bomb that was accidentally dropped from an aeroplane, whether it would be a nuclear bomb in a suitcase or a carry case that didn't go off, whether that might be a nuclear missile taken from a Russian submarine that was trapped on the bottom of the ocean bed and smuggled out, whether Mossad never actually got round to do what it needed to do to end, you know. They've had countless opportunities to bring about the New World Order, and it hasn't happened. And I would agree with Randy. I think a number of people are seeing that it's not going to happen in the way that it's been promised. A number of very, very powerful bloodline families feel betrayed because they were promised a new world order in which they would be the ruling elite, and it hasn't been delivered. And this is primarily what's causing the fracture amongst that ruling elite, who can basically staring down the end of a gun, because at 2017, they really will have to face an issue. So consciousness is rising to the point that, and Randy mentioned about all the psionic interference that's been sent or beamed against people, whether it's paedophilia, whether it's mind control in another form. But humans are becoming resistant, or many humans are coming resistant to it. And we're even seeing the established media, the mouthpiece of the elite, beginning to start to ask questions. So the cracks are appearing, and I just see this as an ongoing process of this ascension. I'm using the word ascension because that's what I think people understand. It's an awareness, an awakening, so that, you know, if you stand and you watch a magician, and you watch a magician do a trick, and you ask that magician to do the same trick 10 times, there comes a point where you understand how the magician is doing the trick. But you don't take the eye off the ball, you don't take the eye off the cups, whatever the cards are. But if you watch hard enough, you begin to see through it. And that's what's happening. And the problem for the magicians, and Randy did sort of touch on this, some alien creatures don't have the ability to create. They have the ability just to replicate or copy. And so many of these people, once they've run out of their ideas, once they've run out of their magic bag, they've got no other tricks to put forward, and humanity is seeing through it. And these people are in a flight of panic. So it is a very interesting and exciting time, but it's also a very dangerous time. That's my view.
Thank you. Yeah, Randy, would you like to comment on what Simon just shared?
Sure. Let's see. I'm sorry. I was making mental notes there to myself. I should have been having a notepad next to me. I was thinking of three different things, and then I got lost near at the end. Hold on. Let me see. We try and retrace my steps here for a
sure.
Time. Okay, so 2017, certainly a time where we're coming close to where I would say that if you just look at the past century and see how the tactical movement of what I consider to be the larger chessboard, we've definitely just been moving towards endgame, and certainly we're at that point where as we approach sort of between now and 2017, all I can say is, yeah, we're getting closer and closer and closer and closer to end game sort of, you know, what's happening on the board sort of status. So what exactly that means and what exactly, I don't like to speculate. I'm a military tactician, and we're in the middle of a war and a conflict, and so I don't like to make too many predictions about how things are going to go or come out exactly, because we're still in the middle of that to see exactly how it's going to go. But I think that we have seen huge divisions on these upper levels where, you know, some of these sort of, you know, global controllers are not you know, having a good time with their other global wealthy family elite folks and starting to have serious disagreements. And my understanding of this is because a very tiny few of them said, no, 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 we've got this great plan and it'll be the, you know, we'll get the whole world and everything. But it became, screw you guys, we're going to keep our little tiny hovel here on Mars, that we're going to have our superior genetic Nazi gene pool, and the rest of you are screwed. And when the rest of the wealthy family realized that they were not actually being included in that plan, then they started to rebel for personal preservation. So watching the Rockefellers divest their oil money, oh my God, that was so amazing. I was just like, oh, you guys are done for now. The Rockefellers took their oil money out, say goodbye to oil, and then the Navy just decided to release that they have a process to make fuel for their ships and their planes from seawater that they're going to start using now, so they're going to stop purchasing oil and petroleum for their boat, for their ships and their planes. I mean, there's some movements to show that the people who are like, oil, 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 are no longer in favor, and that people in serious positions of power and authority are essentially giving the finger to oil production and just saying, no, we're not doing it anymore. We're taking our money out. We're putting our technology elsewhere. Screw you guys. So the Koch brothers can want to, you know, dig shale oil and frack shale all they want, but if the Rockefellers pull their money out of oil and the Navy, which is one of the largest consumers of petroleum products in the world, says we're not going to use it anymore, that's the beginning of the death knell. That's the beginning of the end for oil use. You have this saltwater battery powered car that they've just released out in Germany or something. They put out and said, oh, guess what? Now we have a saltwater powered car. Of course, it's some luxury model that you have to be rich to buy, but the technology could be put into a Ford Focus. You know, it's not, it's the same kind of technology. You still have these, we could still, you know, take hydrogen cracking and crack hydrogen right out of saltwater, like, Stan Meyer, who built his water-powered dune buggy in the late 1970s, did, and Daniel Dingle, who is a Philippine inventor who has made a device as well. He basically, you know, fixes toasters and invented a similar system that he powers. I think he put it into a 90-something Honda Accord or something that basically just sends, cracks the salt water, sends the hydrogen in a little tube right into the internal combustion engine, and, you know, because it's hydrogen, it takes this tiny, tiny, tiny little amount to make the pistons run and then kicks out water, which eventually will rust a steel engine, but, you know, ceramic engine parts and so forth are how you deal with that sort of thing. So all this stuff is coming out that we no longer need to be dependent and we no longer need to be beholden to fossil fuels. And we're actually seeing for the first time these big players, the big financial families, the big military contractors, and the Navy, and finally some car manufacturers who are saying, no, we're turning the other direction. That's the beginning of the end for oil. So oil can struggle all at once for the next few years going, we're going to oil it all, but it's losing. It's a losing battle that it won't win. So I think what we're going to be achieving is seeing these rapid changes of people shifting sides, as I already talked about before, because people realize that they got sold out, and now that they have to switch their position and go with another plan, or everyone's doomed. And that's meant that this one tiny little group of neo-Nazi idiots has really sunk themselves, because they thought that they could fool everyone right up to that last minute. But like Simon says, a magician doing the magic trick, it's like they have to keep doing the same magic trick over and over and over again. And after a while, people go, hey, I think that's an effed up trick. You're trying to just keep us in here while the gas keeps turning up and we're all going to die. You're doing that magic trick to distract us. And they're realizing that, you know, you continue letting this person distract you and try and run the world. They're not going to run the world. They're going to destroy the whole thing. And so you better find someone else to put in the wheel of the car, or they're going to drive it off the cliff, so to speak.
Thank you. Now, going back to Simon's point, which is very interesting, he said, well, that's how ascension is working. Are we going through an ascension, which can be taken many different ways, but I think it's an increase of consciousness or expansion of consciousness or frequency. And Simon can comment on that in just a moment as part of this. Getting back to Mars and Earth and Mars, do you think that Earth and Mars are simultaneously going through, quote, an ascension? That is a mutual expansion of consciousness inside a universe expansion and escalation of consciousness frequencies. We'll start first here with Simon, because you made that observation.
All within the solar system. Yeah. All the planets are heating
Yes,
up.
Right, exactly.
All the planets are heating up, and all the planets are changing, and any living creature that has a free will actually be undergoing some form of change. The thing is, with the human race is a prison race, therefore its changes needs to be the greatest, and this is the problem. It's like overheating. Some people will get it and some people won't. If you look at the Freemasons, this is why the Knights Templars are splitting from the other groups of Freemasons. The Knights Templars are preparing underground bases, simply because, as Randy said, when they looked at their ticket to get off the planet, theirs was a fake. And so few people have actually got the real ticket, that those that are left in positions of power are preparing for the worst, simply because they know the mindset of some of these people, and they want to have a fallback position themselves, hence why these private underground bases are being built under military establishments on Earth, which you can buy for so many million dollars. I mean, that's what's going on, because what happened was that the second tier elite found that they had more bunkers than they needed, so they started selling them to make money. Right. So that's what's happened there. On the ascension side of it, it is interesting, because Randy now on four occasions has mentioned the word Nazi, and that's absolutely correct, because when Germany lost the Second World War, it actually won the peace, because America was so impressed with the level, not just of physical technology, but with the level of mental technology it discovered, that it realized that it could not afford to let any other country in the world have this. And so the Nazi ideology, through individuals, but through corporate views, actually pervaded. For instance, in 1936, when the Germans were developing their Fritz remote control bomb, which was the first camera-operated glide bomb ever in the world, the factories, I think there were three or four German companies making this, all the staff were compartmentalized into groups, so that no one group had the overall picture and no one group could talk to another group. And the Americans actually took that lock, stock and barrel and just replicated that right across the side. And when the Americans went in and found all the underground bases that the Germans had built, they replicated that. So Randy's absolutely right that it's not just an ideology. For many things, it's a way of life, it's a pattern. Now, Alfred, you know, but Randy may not know, that when my mother worked for British Intelligence, the NSA, her job was to type out documents from German scientists from paperclip. Mm-hmm. So she didn't translate them, they were translated for her, Randy, but she typed them out. And these were a group of German scientists who were looking at exotic technologies. Mm-hmm. So the Germans really had a very, very powerful effect on the command and control structure, and it was how corporations basically usurped the political control. And Mars is important because some of the races on Mars can trace a link through to what I would call Aryan type linkage. And so the native Marsh humans have a very close connection with what we could loosely call a Nazi type ideology. Doesn't mean they're bad, it's just that there is a connection there through history.
So how would this connect with the quote ascension or expansion of consciousness? Is that occurring on Mars? That is, are similar consciousness energy processes occurring on Mars as are occurring here?
Yeah, I'm sorry, Alfred. I thought I'd explain that.
I'm just too simple-minded and I didn't catch it.
Alfred, how can you possibly be simple-minded? That is ridiculous.
It's very early in the morning here. I'm sorry.
No, I don't accept that, Alfred, that you're far from simple. Let me just take it to another notch. Many, many hundreds of thousands of years ago, many millions of years ago, it was well known that the human race would at some point ascend, and I'm using the word. Now, when an entire species advances, it creates the most enormous amount of energy.
I see.
Now, other creatures who are trapped in a pit and can no longer escape from that because they've lost the ability to be spiritual, could get on the back of that and ascend with that. But because the way the universe is, because the way Source or God, however you want to look at it, there are certain rules that everybody has to play by. And one of those is that you cannot ascend on the back of another race unless you have moved towards a good position. You've moved far enough across. So, beings like the mantids, who are actually trapped just as much as the humans are in their own position, would like to advance with that. The draconis are undecided because they are so stuck in their world of ceremony and ritual and I am God and I will kill and eat who I want. But there are some of them who are saying, we're finished. We've had it. We're in a cul-de-sac. Here is a way to see if we can work with humans and see if we can get out of this mess. So the ascension process is well known and has been divined or predicted for a very long time, much longer than the Mayan calendar, much longer before that. Every race on every planet in the whole multiverse goes through this process, Alfred. Every sentient living creature will advance. How else do you get to the fourth frequency, the fifth, the sixth, the seventh, the eighth? If you survive and you change, you move up the ladder because you develop. You've got a contact there. Somebody wants you, Alfred.
My wife. Thank you. She's joined us at.
Hello.
Hello there.
I'm just telling you that I'm leaving.
Okay.
I'll be back later.
Okay. Thank you.
Have a good conference.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There we go. Sorry.
That's nice. So basically, that ascension is something that a number of species actually want to happen. The people who don't want to happen it are a large group of draconis reptilians who want to keep the status quo and their subservient grouping who run some elements of the planet. Now, they're the ones that want to maintain the situation, but the majority now want this advancing change. And finally, there are other alien entities from the higher frequencies, so beyond the fourth dimension, who are now throwing out the rule book and are interfering to try and bring a level playing field. So they're not coming in to win the war for the human race, because that's not allowed, but they are balancing it out to make it easier for the good guys to get to the top. And I really am interested in Randy's take on that.
Well, that's okay. So now there's another thing. I like try and get through five things to get to that. There is the rule where people aren't allowed to just come in and fix it. They're not allowed to just come in and solve it, but they are absolutely allowed to make it more fair. So anything that they do, you know, to balance the scale is sort of considered by any of the intergalactic judiciary bodies to be, okay, that's all right. You know, they just kind of go, yeah, okay. They didn't tip the scale, you know, out of balance. They just tried to make it more fair. And anything that anybody does to do that is considered allowed. So it is, there is a technical, you know, space where what do we want, what do we wish we could do versus what we're allowed to do, and then how do we find, you know, a place where we can do something that's effective and helps the scale move but doesn't violate, you know, our, you know, laws and sanctions, which could get then someone to say, hey, you violated that one too many times, you know, back to the perimeter of the solar system, you know, until you can prove that you can behave yourself. And no one wants to get, you know, kicked out of the environment just because they stepped over a line. So most of the time, everyone really observes the rules and boundaries that they're set under because they want to be able to do the most effective thing that they can. And so they have to play by whatever rules or whatever treaties have been established for them to go by. As far as ascension of consciousness and the connection between Earth and Mars, the consciousness, everybody that I've talked to is very much of the liking mind to say that the consciousness of Earth and Mars are sisters and are very, 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 very intimately connected because of our interspecies moving back and forth over many, 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 many hundreds of thousands or maybe even millions of years. So I don't think that it's a coincidence at all that we're experiencing collective ascension or harmonic rising of any kind at all. In fact, I would say that that amplification of that connection, you know, extends beyond to the rest of the solar system and through the Sol system and makes it even more possible that, you know, other beings and planets can all go through this sort of ascending process. And Simon's also correct in say that other species who realize that this is an opportunity for them to sort of surf the wave and, you know, get some elevation from something they can't. They've been pushed down even in some cases farther than we have, and their ability to really sort of try and spiritually develop themselves is even harder. I mean, it's even to imagine harder than it is for us even to do so. And so they're looking for any methodology which might help elevate them as well. But there are rules. You can't just do that, you know, because you also have to be part of the solution, not part of the problem. So you have to be able to come in and say, yeah, we agree in doing this elevating consciousness thing. We're going to help you elevate. We're going to do something for us to elevate. You don't just to get jump on the surfboard and ride the wave. You have to consciously, with intent and action, shift what you're doing to be of that other consciousness. So in some cases, you're talking about factions of extraterrestrials who really believe that they have to be different, be better, express a higher level of consciousness in order to try and jump onto that wave with everyone else to help their own species. While you may have factions within that species, just like we have, who are like, nah, I don't think we want that, and are trying to fight all the time with it. I want to add to the draconian question and the draconian problem. They certainly are having a situation where the number of actual draconian reptiles in their entire gene pool and in their entire consciousness pool is shrinking and shrinking and shrinking and shrinking and shrinking. It's a finite number that keeps getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, because my understanding at this point, they're afraid to breed with each other because they're so dangerous and so hostile that, you know, if they attempt to get together and breed to make another pure Siakar draconian, which is these large, you know, sort of dragony species, not the little ones, but the big ones, that they might just kill each other in the process. And they're so long-lived, but they continue to cheat and cheat and cheat and cheat in order to add years to their lives. So they're on a finite course to a dead end that's either we can stretch this out as long as we can, or we can change course. And there are those who simply have been on this course too long to change it, so they're not going to change their course. They're like, no, we're going to keep, you know, trying to consume and consume and extend our lives. Where there are those who are just like, oh, we've had enough of this. You know, I'm not happy with this. You know, there are parts of those draconian members who are just like, this is not working. I'm not happy with this. You're not happy with this. We haven't created anything that's good. We haven't created anything that's long-lasting that's going to make the world or the universe a better place. All we've done is be selfish, 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 and crap wherever we go. I'm kind of ashamed of that. So there is that division between the members of that own group as they're facing extinction. They are facing a finite extinction that they're eventually going to get to if they don't either learn to breed again or learn to sort of raise their own consciousness, because essentially they're genetically engineering all their middle managers, all their warrior caste, and all of that will fall apart the instant that their upper caste dies off. All of that will just completely disintegrate.
Do you have any comment on that, Simon? Or?
No, it sounds the dilemma that they have been faced. I would add that, but they've known this. That's the problem. They've known this from the beginning. But as Randy said, they just hoped it would go away.
Yeah.
Right. Well, you know, talking of Earth and Mars, there is some research, and you gentlemen can confirm it perhaps more than I, that suggests that prior to 9500 BC or some date of a solar system catastrophe, Earth and Mars were openly an interplanetary society. You know, you can see ruins of under the rulership of the predecessors of the Egyptian pharaohs. You see all sorts of Egyptian art on the surface of Mars. And we've seen that through the efforts of Andy Bishago, who's headed up the Mars Anomaly Research Society curatorship of the NASA rover photos showing sarcophagi that have the carved statue of what looks like an Egyptian king that is with a conical headdress, like the Nefertiti conical headdress to hide the quote cone head effect.
Right.
And so some people say that there was a solar system catastrophe that led to the ecological effects of the current surface of Mars that led to the destruction of our maritime civilization on Earth. That was the end of the openly interplanetary society of Earth and Mars, and that sort of started up again around 1900 with the Martians signaling Tesla, and one thing led to another. J.P. Morgan furnished him. The Illuminati, working through Skull and Bones. My alma mater, Yale, was the second chapter of the Bavarian Illuminati, founded in 1776. And their mission was to reestablish the colonies on Mars, which has led, you see, Dick Cheney was a year ahead of me at Yale and flunked out his sophomore year, but he got into the non-Yale Skull and Bones. And so this was all this all comes from the Bavarian Illuminati, which is reestablishing the old pre-solar system catastrophe, Earth-Mars interplanetary society, which you've experienced as a Earth-Mars Defense Force and the Mars Colony Corporation. It's a bunch of Yaleys in secret societies. I was in an above ground called Torch and Talon, which Skull and Bones infiltrated, and they shut me down on my night, which is how I kind of felt it. I've always been kind of the insider whistleblower on that realm, and so that's why I'm blowing the whistle on Dick Cheney tonight. That's my little contribution to this circle. Okay, so my question is this. Their plan is to kind of exploit Mars, exploit Earth, and have an uber prison planet on both, kind of an elite theme park on both, and transfer their elite, you know, depopulate the useless eaters on Earth, bring over the elite meet to greet, and have them repopulate and become surface dwellers on Earth. It seems that that's not occurring because we've shifted over to a positive timeline with unity consciousness coming in through the interdimensional portal of our universe as of December 21st, 2012, according to our scholars like Dr. Carl Johan Kalman embedded in the Pleiadian calendar known as the Mayan calendar. So that's very good news. What I heard you saying, both of you gentlemen, was that was the good news. And that is that both Earth and Mars are being liberated, and at some point we will have a public unification of the colonies of Earth and Mars. On Earth now, we have kind of a public society, but the public society on Earth is the human Earthling colonization of Mars is being hidden because it's being run by the Cheney, the Dick Cheney and the Skull and Bones machine and the Illuminati machine. That is being shredded by the positive timeline and unity consciousness, because duality consciousness, which is I win, you lose, kind of, you know, plus minus, is being phased out. And so the inevitable result seems to be, after 9,500 years or more, a peaceful or an integration, a reintegration of an Earth-Mars interplanetary society of a positive sort, and a liberation of humans from their prison planet, and a learning to live in a multi-species, multicultural society vis-a-vis Mars. That is, Mars being a multi-species society. How's that for a vision? I open the floor for comments, Simon.
It will be that way if I have anything to say about it.
Great.
Simon, go ahead. That's all I have to say.
You have comments about it.
If I have anything to say about it, yes, it will.
Well, we know of Sirius A and Sirius B and the star systems, and it was predominantly from these star systems that what I would refer to as higher humans colonized Mars a very long time ago. And it was these higher humans that then interacted on Earth, and that's the connection with the human line. These creatures are the creatures that brought the Sphinx, the technology for the Great Pyramid, and that is why you see very similar structures on Mars, where certain aspects are being celebrated. And that goes back much, much longer than many people understand.
At least hundreds of thousands of years, to my understanding.
Yes, yes, I agree with that. I think the future is exciting. Mars was decimated by a nuclear type explosion, and in fact, even today, if you had a basic Boy Scout equipment, you would detect the radiation spikes in some parts of Mars, and that's why some parts of Mars are off limits, and Randy will know that. But Mars does have some very interesting minerals, some very interesting metals, which do take the attention of certain species. The other thing is that Mars is a very handy base for skipping across to the moon, and it's a very interesting detecting point for craft coming into locality within the Earth. So Mars has a strategic value, not just an economic value, and Randy will know that.
Yeah, for sure.
The moon also, but then the moon, its creation is somewhat different from Mars. And if we go back to the days of the Bible, and the Bible says that Adam and Eve left the Eden, and I've got no problem with that, except, of course, I know that there wasn't just Adam and Eve. There were many hundreds of human-type creatures, and what the Bible doesn't tell you is that Adam and Eve split these humans into two groups, and they both left the Garden of Eden, and that's exactly why there is a base on Mars and a base on the moon, and they're called Adam and Eve, because it is representing the fact that the humans exodus left the Garden of Eden two waves, and so that is why you have the Adam and Eve base on the Mars and the moon. So we are linked, and it was very interesting that Randy physically joined his two fingers together to show how inexorably linked Mars and Earth is. And he used the term the sister planets, and that actually is a term used by people in the know. The sad thing is that the red sister is reasonably well destroyed, has had its most of its atmosphere ripped off it, but not entirely. And what I would say is that we mustn't allow that to happen to this sister. And I would much prefer to have a happy, decent life for myself and my children on this planet than have to go into an artificially maintained biosphere on a planet that, yes, is connected to us, but isn't my planet of choice. And it just shows the mindset of some people who are prepared to live a life on a very difficult planet, a very difficult environment, just to escape a world which they feel that it is beyond their control to maintain, because the system now is become greater than the individuals. And that is the timeline we're on, a positive timeline. About 15 to 20 years ago, the timeline changed, and then the bad guys have not been able to bring that back. They come close on two occasions to drag this line back, but they haven't, and now it's too late. So this is the line they're on. This is where we're going.
Thank you. May I ask you one question? From an historical perspective, could you share with us what the origin and circumstances were of the nuclear explosion that did such damage to Mars?
May I ask you why you're asking that question, Alfred, please?
Number one, as an exopolitical historian, I have profound interest. Number two, from a cautionary standpoint for Earth.
Right. It was a suicide. I'm not going to go into huge detail. It was a suicide mission to take out a particular base. It was a mission from which the inhabitants of the weapon knew they would never return. It was effective, and it was over-effective. It ripped off the atmosphere. A lot of the water that was on Mars ended up on Earth. A lot of the life organisms was put on Earth. That's why we've got stuff from Mars on our planet. And it damn near destroyed this planet as well. But that wasn't the intention. So it was a military operation to take out a base, which was too successful.
And approximately, what was the date of that?
Do you mind if I don't tell you that?
Oh, okay. No, that's fine. Can you give any details as to the nature of the military operation? That is, who against
yes,
who? Or?
I don't think that's a problem. If anybody's ever watched any of my presentations, I know I upset people when I talk about Pleiadians being quite warlike. If you listen to YouTube videos, everybody wants to be a Pleiadian because they're the good guys. Nobody wants to be a reptilian, by the way.
Right.
And what I would say is that that the Pleiadians give as good as they get. They are actually incredibly warlike. Doesn't mean they're not good people, mm-hmm. but they are very warlike. And this was a Pleiadian suicide mission to take out their arch enemies who had a base, and it was rather too effective. Okay.
I see. And there was no... And I take it that there are no interplanetary judicial authorities that took umbrage to that?
All right, Alfred.
I'm a lawyer and a judge. I mean, that's an outrage.
Gonna weep right. into the next okay. question.
Actually, I'll go along with what Randy said earlier. Sometimes somebody tips the balance in one way. How do you bring that balance back? you have two ways to bring the balance back. You either do it diplomatically or you do it militarily. If you cannot bring it back diplomatically, then a military solution is found. The diplomat failed, the military solution went in. And that's what happened. So in actual fact, the universe agreed with that action because everything else had been tried and failed. And this was the last point to create it, a physical happening. Because you know what? The universe knows if you let something or someone get away with something, they just keep on pushing and pushing and pushing. And that's what happened.
Now, I'll just push with a couple of questions. Was that event part of what one would call the Lucifer Rebellion?
No.
No. Okay. So this was just plain kind of turf war against
This is between a higher human group and a reptilian group who really don't like each other.
I see. And it was just the base. It was not, that is, there were other humans on that planet.
Right, well, if you find Pleiadian human beings with Pleiadian souls, which there are plenty of them on the planet, if they are in connection with themselves, they are absolutely full of karma. And that's why many Pleiadians are chewed up inside, because in order to carry out that mission, that on behalf of that whole race, they did kill a large number of, what do you call them, non-combatants.
Yeah.
And the Pleiadian race has a massive amount of karma because of that one incident. And that's why Pleiadians, as a large number, have been incarnating on planet Earth to attempt to undo that karma. Although, for most people, they don't remember why they're doing it.
Right. And it's not only a large number of people, but also a Gaia, a living planetary organism, was destroyed. It was ecocide.
Yes.
So these are all violations, I assume, of galactic and universal norms that exist and are enforced variously by galactic governance.
Yes, but Randy knows that in order to save the millions, you sometimes have to kill the thousands.
Right.
And that was the decision taken. You see, Alfred, you're looking at it from a lawyer's perspective. Randy will look at it from a military perspective. And so it is very interesting, your two takes on it.
Well, no, I'm looking at it from Mars' perspective. I think Mars took a beating. And look at poor Mars. It was killed.
Well, let's see what Randy has to say, because I'd be interested.
Well, I mean, it wasn't killed. It was you know, beaten within an inch of its life and left in the gutter to die. But, I mean, it didn't die. It survived. To the point of causing a huge amount of reflection amongst the indigenous folks who live there and their ways to say, maybe we made this happen because we just couldn't stop fighting. And so there was a huge change in perception and attitude, so that the majority opinion of the raptors on Mars is take care of Mars. They really have no concern about trying to fix the rest of the galaxy, trying to get in anybody else's business. They have no interest in conquest. I mean, I have to agree with Simon that the reptilian brain tends to want to be warlike and conquesting, and the draconians certainly have this very reptilian brain. But I would also argue that it's very possible for raptors and reptiles to evolve and to get to a point where they can go, you know, maybe that's not the best way to do things. And I can know of three reptile species that I can think of right off the top of my head who all share sort of an evolved attitude about aggression, where they had to learn from some experiences way back in their history that if you just keep doing that, it's going to end you in a very, very bad, awkward place. So the native raptors now on Mars tend to have one of two ways of doing things, which is to either keep fighting amongst themselves as a way of trying to cleanse and purify themselves. Believe it or not, they continue to see that continuing to fight amongst each other is a way of purging and cleansing this this thing from themselves, because they one of the things that they do anymore is they refuse to use advanced technology when they fight each other, except when they're absolutely forced to. So when I talk about, you know, being confronted by, you know, phalanxes of reptiles carrying savage weapons, and people are like, well, why didn't they have plasma guns? And I'm like, because they don't believe in them. It's not really their way of doing things. They don't think that they're bettering themselves by engaging in combat in a dishonorable way, and they feel that it's better to go into battle and die with honor than to, you know, stab somebody in the back and win. So part of what they feel like they're going through karmically is this cleansing process, which is very violent and very aggressive and, you know, is very, very fighting amongst themselves, you know, like, you know, we kind of bashed each other in through the 13, 14, and 1500s, you know, large groups of people coming together and beating each other with blunt objects in order to sort of, you know, work out issues. And that's kind of where they feel like they're at. Our experience with the northern tribes is they also have the sort of attitude of, you know, fighting through honor and honor through fighting, but they also have a very evolved attitude about their consciousness and their relationship with the planet. So that they feel very, very connected to the consciousness of their planet and basically feel like their entire goal right now is to keep connecting with the consciousness of their planet, to heal their planet, terraform the planet back. When they can, you know, restore vegetation and water across the surface of the planet and have healed the planet, then they can feel like they did their job, which is, we broke it, we have to fix it. So it doesn't matter how long it takes us. If it takes us 10,000 years, 20,000 years, 50,000 years, it doesn't matter. You know, we're going to tear off all our advanced equipment and put our computers down, and we're going to get out our shovels and our hose and we're going to fix it. So it's a very honorable attitude. But I wouldn't necessarily say that that means that you should just walk up to any one of them and go, hey, have a hug, because chances are you're going to get eaten. You know, raptors and reptiles are just not, they're not fuzzy. You know, you don't just walk up to them and say hi. Really, to be honest, If you want to greet a group of reptiles, you have to come into the group. You have to stand there and do this sort of like Maori thing, like, you know, I'm standing in my space, and then, you know, spit on the ground and challenge one of them. And then one of them come and you'll have like this wrestling match. And if you can fare, then they'll consider yourself worthy to actually then say hi to. But if you can't fight and prove yourself worthy, you're a snack.
I'm very interested in what Rand is saying there, because I'm aware that there is a group that do not use energy weapons. And would you refer to this group as the Scimitar group, Randy?
Say that again. Refer to them as the what now?
Would you refer to them as the Scimitar group, the group that used curved swords?
Yes, yes, yes. That was mainly the tribes that we dealt with and faced in combat, and that I personally got to communicate with experience eventually. Yeah, absolutely. That would be them.
Yes. Thank you. That's great. Thank you.
Yeah. I would just add to all of that, that I think that the changing in consciousness is part of what they're going through for their own reasons because of what happened to them. And they have some very different attitudes about how to work through that. But they would very much like to see, you know, Earthlings and terrestrial, you know, Martians get back together as sort of communicating and being friendly again. And it was really when, you know, we were captured, our squad was captured, and they essentially blood tested everyone. And when they came to me and were like, you're more like us than everyone else. Why? We need to understand that, because if you're that much like us, then that means you're a cousin. And if you're a cousin, that means we can't hate you. That means you're our family. So we have to understand if you're really our cousin or not, and we have to treat you like family. And in order to do that, we're going to try and teach you the family ways. And if you can understand the family ways, then you must be family, and then, you know, we'll treat you like family. And so at that point, the discussion changed from, you know, we have to fight with these humans because there are, you know, invaders, to we have to help the small children humans who don't understand who they are, and we have to help them grow up and understand themselves. So,
Randy, it's amazing. We've nearly come to the end of the show, and we finally got something out of you. In the sense that when we first started, within a few minutes, I said to Randy, you have a lot of reptilian in you, which Randy agreed. And now it's interesting that Randy's actually sharing with us that when he was checked over, there was something there which showed, I detected that straight away, Randy. Mm-hmm. It was very obvious to me that you had a connection there. And it's just really nice that you've now sort of come out and said, actually, yes, I do, on that level. And it may well have not just saved your life, Randy, but more than that, it elevated you into a position where communication was then opened between that group and your commanding officers and beyond them, right, which said, this guy can do a little bit of work between both of us, and he does come under our protection. So I think that's quite pivotal, Randy.
I think that's absolutely true. And my experience of that was essentially when, you know, they said, well, we think you're like us, so we have to figure this out. Well, okay, fine, we're going to keep you alive, but we're killing everybody else in your squad. And I said, no. I said, if you kill everybody else in my squad, you have to kill me too. That's not okay. I said, either we all live or we all die. And when they really, like, you know, were putting the sword to my throat, you really, you mean that? I was like, yeah, either we all live or they all die. Then they finally said, okay, that proves that you're more like, that proves you're more like us than we thought you were, the fact that you're willing to die, you know, for your team members.
That's really important. I'm going to just, hang on, Alfred, I'm just going to say that when I was a young child, there is a initiation process that one has to go through with a reptilian group. And that is that you are given a sword, not a curved sword, a straight sword, and then you have to throw it in the air so it spins. So you stand underneath it, it spins, and as it drops, it's for humans, the humans who are on a program. As the sword drops, most children will run from the sword naturally. Mm-hmm. They're out the program, it's failed. What right. you have to do is catch it by the hilt. So what I'm saying is that the sword, the blade, plays an incredibly important part of some of these groups. That's why we've got the Sword in the Stone story. We've got the Sarmatians from ancient Rome who had the dragon standard and the sword. That culture is absolutely interwoven in many human lines. And it was just interesting to hear about the sword being held to his throat, because, again, that is a ritual, that is a ceremony to test his strength.
Right.
To see if he would back off and sell his friends for his own life.
Yep, exactly.
Now, that is the culture that we deal with. Now, you know, I've been public with this, Randy, that one third of my soul is mantis, one third of my soul is hollow earth human, and the other third is a reptilian, draconis reptilian. So I fully understand exactly what was going on there. And if you weren't a brave man, they would have killed you. Well, they would have actually chopped your head off.
Yeah.
But you were a brave man, and they honored that, and they recognized that. Sorry, Alfred, I beg your pardon, but I thought that was important.
No, thank you. I don't talk about it very often. It's one of those areas that, you know, if I'm really pressed on, I will talk about it. But it's kind of personal, and so it's a little still awkward to try and talk about, because I don't expect people to understand it in any way, shape, or form. And it was such a deeply personal experience that I don't normally talk about it. But I am happy to share with you guys the experience. It was absolutely life-changing in every way that conceivably possible. The message really seemed to be that, you know, I was being tested mentally, emotionally, physically, spiritually, all of these sort of ethical, moral tests and guidelines. And after a certain amount of time being determined that I passed those tests, basically, that's when I got, you know, cut down off the pole that I was hanging off of, you know, by my toes, you know, up like this for how many days, I can't remember. It's a stress position. It wasn't torture. I wasn't like being poked with hot pokers. It was a stress position, you know, so that, I mean, a sun ceremony, you know, is a stress position. You put hooks in yourself and you hang out in front of the hot sun as a way of, you know, getting your mind-body experience to go through a change. So this kind of a stress position was designed to, you know, not to make me torturous or just sort of like, do what we say, but more of like, we want to get at the real answer. And the only way we know we're going to get at the real answer is if we crank up your stress level to a point where you can't lie. And so there was a certain point that there was no way that I not only could or would or had any interest in trying to deceive or say anything that was to save my own skin. I just knew that the only way that I was going to get out of this alive was to tell the absolute truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And either that was going to get me through this, or it wasn't, or I was going to end up dead. So I somehow knew that intuitively and just knew that I had to just keep staying honest. But I'll be honest that part of what's happening with the cortisol levels and the testosterone levels and the endorphin levels and all the things that are happening from that stress position and sleep deprivation does have a way of opening your mind and causing you to get more and more into your pure self if, you know, someone who's really masterful and knows how to do that and isn't just trying to crack you open like a nut. So it was definitely an experience where, you know, they were trying to, you know, peel me away to understand whether or not I was really worthy for them to even talk to and to even have a conversation with and to even try and teach. Is he worthy for us to even try and teach? You know, they had to come to that conclusion before they were going to spend any time. And I feel incredibly honored that they decided that I was worthy. And I spent, you know, it was almost five and a half, less than 6 months or something in their community and lived among them and with them. And it was a really blessed experience. And I got to learn a lot from it. And part of what I got to learn was something that I didn't even know at that time, which is that we were related. We were physically and biologically related up until that point. I mean, that was news to me when, you know, they are saying, well, you're like us. What is up with that? We want to understand. You know, they were asking me, why are you like us? And I was like, I don't know. Kind of, why are you asking me? I have no idea why I'm like you. But they were very curious to understand the answer to that question and really wanted to know, you know, Is this a long lost cousin come back or not?
Another question they may well have asked you, Randy, is why are you here?
Oh, that was definitely asked. And all I could really answer to that was, you know, I'm sworn to do my duty as a soldier and I go where they tell me to go and I do what they tell me to do.
But it's beyond that. It's beyond that. It's
true.
it's why is a creature like you here now at this time? That's what they're asking because they know that you're related. And they're trying to look at the greater picture that's occurring. What has happened to bring you into their world? And that's what's thrown them into that. Now, the other thing that's really interesting, Alfred, is that many of these creatures could just have gone into Randy's head mentally and just got the answer like that. But that's not the way they do it because, again, it's not free will. If you go into someone's head and you take the answer out, that hasn't been given to you freely. So the physical aspect of the work that they did on him was in order to, from their own heraldic military standpoint, it made it honorable, but also there was still free will here because Randy could still have said, you know what, screw you, which I'm sure you did at the early stages, but it because the answer they got was through the process that they got, it meant that they were entirely happy with the whole situation. And that's it. Once they accepted that, then Randy had a ticket that he could go backwards and forwards within reason. And you know, so Randy and I do have some very common interests, actually. Although through different routes, we have actually, you know, understood each other quite well, I think.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. Well, I think that... this is extraordinary. These 2 hours have gone by in a flash. Could you each take a minute and just with any final observations you'd like for us, for our audience, for each other, for the round table? Simon, you want to?
I was going to say Randy first.
Okay. Either of
you. Sure. I think that we've definitely reached a point where, you know, with someone like Simon who's been, you know, who came out to talk publicly about, you know, his experience with extraterrestrials before he ran for office, who was legally elected by a constituency after having come forward to say that, I think that's a huge, huge, huge step in the right direction where we're seeing that the people, regardless I have a friend who's trying to break me of that habit because I had a teacher who said irregardless all the time and taught it to me wrong. And so I've been trying to untrain myself that it's not really a word. So regardless of, you know, how you want to sort of see that experience, it has made it more true that the people are ready to hear the truth regardless of whether the so-called, you know, elected leaders that we have now are willing to admit to it. So we have tons of people in our elected system who are still extraterrestrials. What do you mean, extraterrestrials? But at the same time, we clearly have a vein of so many of them that are pushing and pushing and pushing to try and get people to talk, and the side doors are flying open in every direction, and the side windows and things are flying out in every direction, that I don't think we can really say anymore that there is a concerted effort to keep secrecy anymore. I don't think that's the case. I can think we can say there's a small faction anymore that has got this grip that is still trying to keep secrecy, and everyone else is ready to pry it out of their hands with a crowbar. And I think that based on many of the conversations that we've had today and other things that we've all talked about, we're seeing that happen. We're seeing that happen. We're closer to that than we were 5 years ago, 10 years ago, and we're just going to get closer and closer until we get to a point where, you know, we sort of break the glass ceiling. You know, there is a point where disclosure ends. There's a point where the official, extraterrestrials, what? There's a moment where that ends. Now, where that moment will be, who is going to be the person who has the press conference, or what event will it be that happens, or what person comes out to go from, you know, here on one side, and then now we're here after disclosure on the other side. But it's an inevitable point. It is an inevitable point that we're going to reach pretty darn soon. Will it be 2017? Very possibly. Will it be a little before, a little after? Also very possibly. Do I think it's going to be beyond 2023 or 2024? No, I don't think so. I can't say, yes, you know, disclosure will happen before that. I will say that I will be the most astonished, amazed, and I'd eat my hat if we got to 2023 and we hadn't had some kind of actual disclosure admission by some official apparatus of Western state or government. So I think we're in an amazing process, and we're making amazing progress as we go through step by step. And I want to applaud Simon for being able to speak truthfully and get elected and work for the people and do what he can. I have a friend who I won't name who's in British government, who's, I think, a very, very hard worker and is doing a really great job. And his folks live very, very near you, Simon. So he said, oh, yeah, Simon, my folks live near there. He's a good guy. So yeah, everyone, people around locally like you and think you're a good guy. I've heard that.
Oh, that's really intrigued me. I shan't go into your mind, Randy, and find out what it is, because that would be an invasion of free will.
It would be.
I only use it to protect myself, Randy. I never go out to do anything naughty with it.
No.
I think, looking at the state of American politics, that it is natural that a Republican president will now be elected. The question is, will it be the Bush? Because this will be a very strong indication of the power struggle that's taking place. I think, is it Jeb Bush?
Yes. Jeb with a G.
Jeb Bush.
Yeah, Jeb.
Okay, well, he is the guy that would most hold up our procedure at the moment. So that's the money's on that man at the moment from the elites. However, it will be very interesting, because I'm expecting a new hat to be thrown into the ring before the next presidential election, which I'm not saying that person will win, but what that person may do is cause such a swing of votes that the almost soon to be elected next president might not be the person they expect. So that will have a very powerful effect on disclosure, because if you get a Bush in there, that will hold back disclosure for 2 to 3 years. Right. And finally, there are outside influences that have basically told the American administration that unless they manage disclosure, it will be forced upon them. And in which case they will have no control over how they manage the situation that occurs from that. And that is the problem. Now, what's happened in the past is that the side making that threat has given ground and said, okay, you can have another 6 months, you can have another year, but that's now finished and they've got a deadline. And again, that's another real problem for them. So we are going to get disclosure, and it will have to be through official channels. And it can't come soon enough, Alfred. We all agree it can't come soon enough.
Right. Well, thank you. Thank you both. This is a round table that has left myself and all of us, I think, we're watching with a sense of hope. And I just want to thank you both for having taken time out today. I know that it's very late in the UK to participate with us. And I hope that in the future, that when the occasion merits, we'll be able to reconvene the roundtable once more to pass its wisdom and to bring us fresh insight. Would that be okay?
Absolutely.
Oh,
yeah, absolutely.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Thank you. So thank you, gentlemen, and all power to you.
Thank you. Thanks. It's been wonderful to speak to you, Alfred and Randy. I have enjoyed it. It's not been confrontational. It could have been. But, you know, if we all believe in the greater good, then that's what we are. So, listen, God bless you all. Thanks ever so much. Take care.
Certainly.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you both as well. Thank you very, very much. Semper Fi.
Bye-bye.